Hello students, welcome to lecture number 14, preview of what we did in our last lecture. So in the last lecture we studied four types of ideal processes. Okay, the first type of process that we started was an isothermal process. So in an isothermal process we see that the temperature of the gas remains constant as the pressure and volume changes. So in isothermal process the work done is nothing but the area under this curve. Now work done on the gas is equal to work done on the gas means the gas goes from V2 to V1, that is we are compressing the gas. Okay, we are compressing the gas. So if this is the piston, we are compressing the piston, we are putting in more weights on the piston such that the volume decreases. So the gas goes from V2 to V1 in this direction. So the work done on the gas is nothing but minus of nRT ln V2 by V1. Now if you remember, I told you we consider work to be negative if we are going from right to left. So that's what we have done here. And the other relation that we use is the ideal gas law, PV is equal to constant. The next type of process that we have started was a constant volume process, also called as isochoric. So in constant volume process, the work done and by moving from this point to this point, or this point to this point, is nothing but the area under the curve. In this case, the area under the curve is zero. That's why the work done is equal to zero. The third kind of process that we started was isobaric. Isobaric process is a process where the pressure remains constant. Okay? And the work done in going from V2 to V1, okay, again V2 to V1, we are going in this direction, is nothing but the area under the curve. So the area under the curve is nothing but, if this point is P, then the work done is P times, that is the height, P is the height times this distance V2 minus V1, okay, this length. And since it's going from left to right, we put a negative sign. So work done is area under this curve, which is V2 minus V1 into P, as we have seen here. And the fourth kind of process that we started is called the adiabatic process. Adiabatic process, as we have seen in the last lecture, is a very steep curve when you compare it with the isothermal processes, and the temperature at this point and at the final this point is different, and the work done when we go from this point to this point, from V2 to V1, again we are going in this direction, the work done is nothing but V2 the pressure and volume at this point minus P1 V1, the pressure and volume at this point, divided by gamma minus 1, where gamma is an adiabatic index. So it depends on type of gas that we use. So if it's monoatomic, then it has a particular value. If it is diatomic, it has a particular value. So depending on type of gas that we use, we have to input the value of say gamma. Other relations that are important for adiabatic is, in adiabatic we do not use the ideal gas law, but we use this law. It's the adiabatic law. So P V raised to gamma is equal to constant, and there's another relation that we can find using in terms of temperature and volume, which is this T into V raised to gamma minus 1 happens to be constant. So in today's lecture we will discuss a new concept which is called as the second law of thermodynamics. So today we will discuss the second law of thermodynamics. So we start this part of thermodynamics by asking the following questions. Just this question: there are certain things in this world which are perfectly allowed, but they don't seem to happen. Now to go deeper into this statement that I've just made, let us consider some examples. Let us consider this example. Let's say example number one. Let's say I have gas in a container. Okay, let's say this gas has a barrier at the midpoint and there are gas molecules. So I have a container which has a barrier at the midpoint and there is gas over here. Now if I remove this barrier, what will happen? Once I remove this barrier, what we notice is that the gas will expand all over the container. Okay, so this is what we notice. Now imagine we record a video while we do this process. Okay, I record the video. I start my recording when I remove this barrier, and after some time, the gas has spread all over here. Now, what we notice is if we record the video, is suppose we can see the microscopic molecules. Let me consider one molecule over here. Let me consider one molecule over here. We say that this molecule has some velocity v in this direction. Now the video that I have taken, if I play it backwards, what will we notice is that initially the molecules are spread all over the container, and as time passes, these molecules will move towards the left end of the container. This is what we will notice, and this molecule that we have plotted here with the velocity v will be having a velocity in the opposite direction in the backward video. So we will see that this molecule, which has velocity this, will be moving in the opposite direction. Now this process where we have watched the video in backwards motion, we will see that this process satisfies the first law of thermodynamics, that is the energy is conserved in this process. And as well as we will also see that the other laws of physics are also being followed. For example, this molecule which is moving in the backward video in this opposite direction, it won't violate any laws of physics that we know up till now. Yet this time of process, that is the backward process where the molecules are spread and after some time they occupy the left side of the container, this process won't happen in nature. Okay, now another example that won't happen in nature is the following. Let us consider a block of wood which has a thermometer attached to it, starts moving on a surface. So as I push the block of wood such that it has some velocity and will start moving along the surface. But what we notice is as it's moving along the surface, it loses its velocity. So it loses velocity to friction. And due to this friction, what we see is that the temperature of the block keeps on rising. And ultimately, after some time, the block will be halted, that it will won't have any velocity, and the block will be heated to a particular temperature. Now, if we videotape this this situation and try to play it backwards, what we notice is the following. That a block which is heated up loses its energy in terms of by converting it to velocity and starts moving the block, and it reverses up till to the time where the initially the block was moving with a larger velocity and the temperature was pretty low. Now if we look at this backward video, we see that none of the laws of physics are violated. For example, the first law of thermodynamics, this is nothing but the law of conservation of energy, happens to be followed here. We see that the energy is conserved. So none of the laws of physics that we know have been violated. Yet such a situation doesn't happen in real life. So what we see is some events or processes are irreversible. For example, if I drop a egg which I'm holding in my hand, if I drop it, it falls on the ground and it splatters around. You never see a situation or an event where the egg which has splattered around combines to form the egg and comes from the ground and sits in my hand. So you will never see such a situation. So we see that some things cannot be explained by the laws of physics that we already know. So we elevate all these things to a new law, and it is quite amazing that there is one law that can tell what things will happen and what things won't happen, and this is what we call as the second law of thermodynamics. So the second law of thermodynamics simply states that the entropy of the universe will always increase. So this is what the second law simply means. Now what does this term entropy mean? We will study this in more detail later. So basically what the point that I have tried to make is, in the example cited above, example this example, what actually happens is the entropy of the universe has increased. Hence, if we consider the reversed video, backward running video, what we see is, in the reverse process, the entropy of this, if this process is getting reversed, the entropy of the universe will actually decrease. So the second law says that the entropy of the universe should always increase. So in this case, when we go from here to here, the entropy of the universe has increased. Hence, the reverse process where the entropy decreases is not allowed. Yeah? So the processes which are allowed are that the entropy goes from a less value to a high value. And the amazing part is we can actually get a qualitative as well as quantitative values for this entropy. Now the next part will be, how do we get to this great law of thermodynamics? That is the law of entropy. The second law of thermodynamics is also called as law of entropy. The second law of thermodynamics was discovered by an engineer called Carnot. And Carnot used to work mostly on steam engines. So a steam engine is an engine where we burn coal and we heat up water. And the water produces steam. And the steam in turn pushes the piston. The piston turns the wheels, and the turning of the wheels causes the motion of the train. So that's how a steam engine works. So we can depict the steam engine in the form of a schematic diagram, and it looks something like this. So we take some heat. So we have a reservoir at a high temperature, let's say T1, and we take in some heat from this reservoir and we supply to an engine. So we take in some heat, let's say Q1 heat from this reservoir which is a high temperature, we give it to an engine and the engine does some work. Now this engine can contain any substance. For example, a steam engine will contain its substance as water. For example, a petrol engine will contain its substance as petrol. A diesel engine will contain its substance as diesel. But what we usually see in a real life circumstances is, that the engine always gives out some heat as exhaust. And this exhaust, let us consider the heat given as exhaust is Q2, is given to the atmosphere at a low temperature. So if we have seen the petrol engine, you might have seen the exhaust pipe. So there is some gases coming out of the exhaust. So this is how the engine works. It takes out some heat from a higher reservoir. The engine does some work, and some of the heat is exhausted, given as exhaust to the atmosphere. So the work that we get from an engine is, where we do not work as W, is nothing but the heat that we take in minus the heat that we reject. And we define a new quantity called as efficiency. So efficiency, we denote it as eta, by the symbol eta. So efficiency is nothing but what we get from the engine and what we pay for it. So the work that we get is how far we push the, whether it is a car or whether it is a train. So it's the work that we do. And Q1 is the heat that is applied. It is how do we pay for it. For example, in a steam engine, we burn the coal. For a petrol engine, we burn the petrol. So we pay for the petrol. Now, we can write this efficiency as, by substituting for the work which I have found here, as Q1 and as Q2 divided by Q1. So this is equal to 1 minus Q2 by Q1. So we see that in every engine, some of the heat is taken in, and in some of it is taken to do some work, and some of it is rejected as exhaust. So the efficiency that we see here, which is 1 minus Q2 by Q1, mostly depends on the heat that is rejected. Now you can ask yourself, why don't we build an engine such that it doesn't reject any heat? That is, whatever heat that we take, all of it is gone to do some work and nothing is rejected. So Carnot gave an argument for the most efficient engine you can build. And what he saw was there's an upper limit for this efficiency, and the upper limit of efficiency is not 1. Now if we could convert all this heat into work, there wouldn't have been any exhaust, that is Q2 would have been 0 and the efficiency would have been 1. But Carnot saw that the efficiency is not 1, it is always less than this amount. So now what we're gonna do next is we're gonna find what is the efficiency and how do we find the efficiency. And to find this efficiency, we need a postulate. This postulate is nothing but Carnot's version of second law of thermodynamics. So back then, Carnot didn't know about the quantity called entropy. So Carnot's law says the following. Carnot's law says that you cannot develop now a heat engine. Now this is how a heat engine looks like. You have a higher reservoir, you have a reservoir at high temperature, and you have a reservoir at a colder temperature, T2. So let's say T2 is cold and T1 is hot. Second law of thermodynamics, which is Carnot's version, also called as Carnot's law, says that you cannot develop a heat engine whose sole effect is to transfer heat from the cold body to a hot body. So Carnot's law says that this is not allowed. And this postulate, that is the second law, will put an upper bound on the efficiency of heat engines. Now we will study something called as Carnot engine. So this is the engine that Carnot built. So let me draw the PV. This is Carnot's engine. So this is my PV diagram. So we have two isothermals. Let's say this isothermal is at temperature T1, this isothermal is at temperature T2. We have two isothermals and we have two adiabatic processes. So let's say these are the adiabatic. Remember, adiabatic processes are very steep. The curves are very steep. Now what we do is we take a gas in a piston. Let's say we have a gas in a piston, ideal gas in a piston, and there are some grains of sand on this gas. So let us take a gas and we keep it at this point A. And then what we do is we allow the gas to expand isothermally along this curve till it reaches point B. So what we do is we take this gas and we start removing, we take this piston and we start removing grain after grain. So as the grain is removed, the pressure decreases and the volume increases. But since this process is isothermal, that means this has to be kept on a reservoir. Let's say the reservoir is at a temperature T1. So as we keep on removing the grains, the gas keeps on changing its pressure ultimately till it reaches point B. And just as we keep on removing the grain, since the temperature of this gas has to remain constant, some heat must be added to this system. And let us denote this heat into the system by squally line, and I say the heat inserted in the system is Q1. From point B, we move the gas to point C. Now this process from B to C, we call this point C, is an adiabatic process. An adiabatic process, what we do is, we thermally isolate this piston. That is, we keep on removing the grains, but we do not allow any heat to enter the piston or heat to leave the piston. That is, this is a completely isolated system. So in this adiabatic expansion, what we see is, since there is no heat coming out of the system, that means the temperature of this gas must change. So from B to C, the gas drops to a different volume and a different pressure, but the temperature doesn't remain same. So it goes from T1 to temperature T2. This process is called the adiabatic expansion. And from point C, we move on this part to point D. Now in this process, again, if you look at this part, this is an isothermal curve. Now as in the path C to D, along C to D, what we do is, we put in some weights, that is grains of sand, and we increase the pressure. So as pressure increases, the volume of the gas decreases, And since the volume of the gas has decreased, there should be a rise in internal energy in this. And since this has to be kept at the constant temperature, there will be some amount of heat which leaves the system. So the heat leaves the system and goes into this reservoir T2, such that the temperature remains at T2. So this process which goes from C to D is what we call as isothermal compression. And from D to A, and then from D to A, the process is adiabatic compression. Same as the process B to C, but this is in the opposite direction. So in D to A, what we do is, again we take the piston and we isolate it. And we keep on putting weights such that the pressure is increasing and the volume is decreasing. So this process is what we call as adiabatic compression. Now try to find out what is the work done in following this process A, B, B, C, C, D, D. As we have studied in the previous lectures, the work done is nothing but the area under this curve. Under this curve, that is B's area under this loop A, B, C, D, A. So in order to find what is the work done, and ultimately our goal is to find what the efficiency is of the Carnot engine, what we'll do is we'll consider each process and we'll find out what is the work done in each of these processes. So let us first consider the process AB. So process AB is nothing but isothermal expansion. So in isothermal expansion, what we are basically finding is the area under this curve, that is area under curve AB. Area under curve AB. And let me call this point E and let me call this point G. So basically what we are finding is area under this curve. And for our calculations, what we do is, let us find the value of this point A. So the value of point A is pressure P1 and volume V1. Similarly, the value at point P is P2, V2. At point C, it is P3, V3. And point D, let us take it to be P4, V4. So we have defined what the state variable is at each of these points. In isothermal expansion, in this process, the substance, that is the gas, absorbs a heat Q1 from the source, that is the temperature, such that the temperature remains constant. So the work done is nothing but whatever heat is supplied to the system. We can see this from the first law of thermodynamics. So from the first law of thermodynamics, we know that delta Q equals the heat supplied minus the work done. But since this is on an isothermal T1, the change in internal energy is zero. So that means the work done is nothing but the heat that is supplied. So the heat that is supplied is nothing but the work done. And what is the work done in isothermal process? The work done in isothermal process is nothing but the integral of P dV. Now in order to solve this integral, we need P to be a function of V. So we use the ideal gas law, and as per the ideal gas law, we know that PV is equal to nRT. So using this ideal gas law, we can write this as a function of P. So in this process, let us consider the gas to be of 1 mole. So N is equal to 1 mole. So from this, we get P as N, sorry, no N, we get R, T, this is the temperature in this case is T1, let us write it as T1, integral of dV by V. I can take this out of the integral because these are constant terms. And what does the integral, what are the limits of the integral? We see that it goes from V1 to V2. So the integrals are V1 to V2. So the work done in this process AB is nothing but RT1 ln V2 by V1. Now this value RT ln V2 by V1 is nothing but area under this curve, that is ABGEA. So this is nothing but area ABGEA. Now the next process in a Carnot engine is this BC, which is the adiabatic process. The next process is what we call as adiabatic expansion. So in adiabatic expansion, the work done is nothing but the area under this curve. So let us name this as GBCHG. This point is H. So the area under this curve, BCHGB. So we have to find the area under this curve. So in this process, in this adiabatic expansion process, remember that there is no heat transfer since this full system is under isolation. And we see that the temperature of the gas falls from T1 to T2 at point C. And it does some work, that is the area under the curve. So the work done in adiabatic expansion is equal to again integral of P dV. But for adiabatic process, the function P is not same as for an isothermal process. If you remember, for adiabatic processes, PV raised to gamma is equal to a constant. So this is the equation that we use. So we can write this C as a, this constant as C, such that V raised to gamma, P into V raised to gamma is C. So we can write P as C divided by P raised to V raised to gamma. So using this in this equation, we can write, since C is a constant, we can take it out of the integral, integral dV by V raised to gamma. And if we look at this Carnot engine, the value of the volume goes from V2 to V3, V2 to V3, so V2 to V3. So from this we get the work done is equal to C times V3 1 minus gamma minus C times V2 1 minus gamma divided by 1 minus gamma. We can write this term V3 1 minus gamma as, we can write P V gamma as C, and we can write P is equal to C times V gamma minus 1. So we can use this relation over here. So using this relation over here, what we get is P3 times V3 minus P2 times V2 to 1 minus gamma. Again, over here, what we have used is this. So from this, what we see is P2 times V2 gamma is equal to P3 times V3 gamma, and so on. So whatever point is we are on, or the gas is on in the adiabatic expansion or compression, this equation is always constant. So using this function over here, we get this. And then we can replace this term by using our ideal gas law, which is PV is equal to RT. We can use this, we can convert this in terms of temperature. So what is the temperature at V3? If you look at this diagram, at temperature V3, at the point V3, the temperature is T2. So using ideal gas law, we can replace this as R times T2. And this term at V2, the temperature is T1. So we can replace this term as R times T1 divided by 1 minus gamma. So taking R common, we get this as R into T1 minus T2 into gamma minus 1, rearranging this. And this term is nothing but area under this curve, BCHGB. So this is area under BCHGB. Now we move on to the third process, that is C2D. Now in the third process, what we have is isothermal compression. So again, this process C2D in this direction. Okay, so let's see, in isothermal process, the heat that is rejected is Q2. I have not mentioned it in the diagram, but let's say the heat rejected is Q2. So the gas undergoes compression at a constant temperature T2 and gives off heat Q2 to the reservoir. So as we put in some weights, as we put in some weights in this, as we put in some weights, the pressure increases and some heat is ejected into the reservoir. So heat which is ejected is Q2. So the work done in this isothermal compression is nothing but the heat that is ejected. So work done is nothing but the heat that is ejected. This is from the first law of thermodynamics. So the work that we do is integral P dV. And again, we replace P as a function of V. So we can write this as using the ideal gas law as R times T2, since now the temperature is T2 of the isothermal, integral of dV by V. Now what are the limits in this case? The limits are V3 to V4. So V3 to V4. So this is equal to RT2 ln V4 by V3. Now this term, using the property of log, we can write it as RT ln V3 by V4. Using properties of log, we can just find the inverse of this by using a negative sign. And this is nothing but area under this curve, that is dH, area under this curve. Okay, let us call this F. Let us call this F. So it's area under CHFD. This is area of CHFD, FDC. Now the last process is from D to A, and this is nothing but the fourth process is nothing but adiabatic compression. So adiabatic compression is nothing but the work that we do, the work done under adiabatic compression is nothing but the area under this curve ADFEA. So again, in adiabatic compression, the system is isolated, so there is no heat transfer and there is no heat supplied to the system, no heat coming out or going in the system. So we find the work done, let us denote it as W4. The work done is nothing but P dV V4 to V1, V4 to V1. And using the same function for adiabatic compression, we write it as PV gamma raised to constant C, we write it as dV by V raised to gamma from V4 by V1. And what we get is the same value. I won't do the math over here, you can do it yourself. What we get is the same value as what we get for adiabatic expansion, but with a negative sign. So what we get is this R times T1 minus T2 divided by gamma minus 1. So this is area under DFEAD, is this area under this curve. Now we find the net work done by the engine per cycle. So the net work done by the engine per cycle, that is each cycle, that is the one cycle is going from A to B, B to C, C to D and D to A. This is called as one cycle. So the net work done in going from along this cycle A, B, C, D, A, that is what we call as the per cycle, is nothing but the summation of the work done in each of the processes. So it's the sum of all the work done in each of these processes. So isothermal expansion, adiabatic expansion, isothermal compression, adiabatic. Now what we see from a calculation earlier is that adiabatic compression, that is adiabatic compression and adiabatic expansion and adiabatic compression both have same values, but there's just a difference of sign. So what we see is the work done by adiabatic expansion is equal to minus of work done by adiabatic compression. So since W2 is equal to W4, these two terms cancel out. And the net work done is W1 plus W3, that is isothermal expansion and isothermal compression. So if we substitute these values, what we get is R values for W1 and W2, W3, what we get is RT1 ln V2 by V1 minus RT2 ln V3 by V4. Now this Carnot engine that we have plotted here, we can draw this Carnot engine in a much simpler schematic, just as we had drawn the steam engine. So we can draw the schematic for Carnot engine as follows. We have a reservoir which is at high temperature T1. We take some heat Q2 from the reservoir at a high temperature. We supply to our engine, we do some work, and then we eject heat Q2 to a reservoir which is at a lower temperature T2. So this is what a Carnot engine looks like. So we take some heat Q1, this is Q1. So we take some heat Q1 from a higher temperature, do some work, and reject a heat Q2 to a lower temperature T2. So the efficiency of this engine is nothing but the work that we do divided by the heat that we take in, what we pay for it. So this can be written as Q1 minus Q2 divided by Q1 is equal to 1 minus Q2 by Q1. Now we see that the work that we do in this Carnot engine is nothing but Q1 minus Q2. That means the work that we have calculated here, the value that we have calculated here, this value is nothing but Q1 minus Q2. So now what we can do is we can replace this work done, this value is nothing but Q1 minus Q2. So what we can do is we can substitute this value of work in this equation. So now since efficiency eta equals W plus W divided by Q1, and we can write W as RT1, again this is from what we have found from here. So the net work done that we have found, we can replace this schematic diagram of eta, this W, by this equation. So the efficiency is RT1 ln V2 by V1 minus RT2 ln V3 by V4 divided by RT1 ln V2 by V1. Now if we divide throughout by, divide and multiply by this term RT1 ln V2 by V1, we get this equation. Eta is equal to 1 minus T2 by T1 into ln V3 by V4 divided by ln V2 by V1. This is a equation for efficiency. But we are not done yet. We have to get rid of this term, log of V3 by V4 and log of V2 by V1. What we can show is, we can show that log of V3 by V4 is equal to log of V2 by V1. To show this, let us consider the points A and D. So let us consider the points A and D. Now if you see these points A and D, we see that they lie on the same adiabatic. Since they lie on the same adiabatic, that is points A and D, they lie on the same adiabatic, that means PV gamma at point A, which we have at point A, which is nothing but P1, V1, happens to be equal to P4, V4 raised to gamma. Again, remember these are constants. This is equal to constant. This is the expression of adiabatic processes. We can write this term in terms of temperature as follows. We can write this as T1, V1, gamma minus 1 is equal to T2, V4, gamma minus 1. I can rearrange this term and I write it in terms of T2 by T1. So in terms of T2 by T1, what I have is V1 minus V1 divided by V4 raised to gamma minus 1. Let us call this equation 1. Similarly, let us consider point B and C. So points B and C. So at point B and C, T1 V2 gamma minus 1 equals this point, that is T2 V3 gamma minus 1. And rearranging these terms in terms of T2 by T1, what I have is V2 by V3 into gamma minus 1. So let's call this equation 2. Okay, so I've already termed this term as equation 1. So this is equation 2 and this is equation 3. Now if you look at equation 2 and 3, both have T2 by T1 and equation 3 also have T2 by T1. So what we can do is we can equate both these equations, that is 2 and 3, and what we get is V2 by V3 is equal to V1 by V4. So if we rearrange this, we can write V2 by V1 equals V3 by V4. Now since these are equal, what we can do is we can take log on both sides. So taking log on both sides, we get V2 by V1 is equal to ln V3 by V4. We can take log on both sides. Now this equation, we see that log of V2 by V1 is equal to log of V3 by V4 is the same thing as what we have in equation 1. So since both these terms happen to be equal, both of these terms gets cancelled. So efficiency for the Carnot engine happens to be equal to eta equals 1 minus T2 by 3T. This is, T2 by T1. This is efficiency for Carnot engine. What we see is that the efficiency depends only on the temperature of the hotter reservoir and the cooler reservoir. So what we see is that the efficiency doesn't depend on the type of gas that we use. It just depends on the temperature of the reservoir. It can be also shown that no engine can be better than the Carnot engine. So that means this efficiency that we get from a Carnot engine is the theoretical maximum. Another important thing about the Carnot engine is that it is perfectly reversible. So in this Carnot engine, we go from A to B by pulling out some greens from the piston. So we can run this engine backwards, that is instead of going from B to A to B, we can go from B to A by putting in some greens and by giving out some heat. So this engine can be run in the reverse direction, that is in backward form. And if we run this engine in backward form, the schematic looks something like this. So we have two reservoirs, that is one it has a higher temperature and one it has a lower temperature. This is our engine. So we give in some work W, we take out some heat from the cold reservoir, let's say Q2 as depicted in this diagram, and we give out some heat to a higher reservoir. So if we have to plot the reversible Carnot cycle, it will look something like this. So AB, so it will go, so look something like this. Again, there are two adiabatics and two isothermals. So instead of going it along the clockwise direction, what we'll notice is for reversible cycle, it will go along this path. So A, B, C, D. So it will take in some heat Q2 and will give out some heat Q1 to the higher temperature reservoir. Now this gadget that we have drawn here, this engine that we have drawn here, is nothing but a device that we already know, which we call it as refrigerator. So this is how a refrigerator works. You give in some work, it takes up some heat from a cooler reservoir and gives out some hotter heat to the atmosphere. So this is how refrigerator works. And the work input that we give in over here, that is the work that we do over here, is Q1 minus Q2. And just in the case of Carnot engine, we found something called as efficiency. So it tells us how efficient the engine is. For a refrigerator, that is a reversible Carnot cycle, what we find is something called as coefficient of performance. CO is written as COP, so coefficient of performance. So coefficient of performance gives us nothing but the ability of the refrigerator. So coefficient of performance is mathematically defined as the heat that is extracted divided the work that we give in. So what we want, how much of heat that we want to be removed, and how much we pay for it, that is by how much work we do. So from the derivation of Carnot cycle, what we can see is, if you remember from the schematic, we get the efficiency as Q2 by Q1, and from a Carnot mathematical derivation we get eta is equal to T2 by T1. So comparing this two, what we can see is Q1 by Q2 equals T1 by T2. So using this relation to find our coefficient of performance, we get coefficient of performance is equal to T2 by T1 minus T2. So just by knowing the temperatures of both the reservoirs, we can find the coefficient of performance. Similarly, just by finding the coefficient, the temperature of reservoirs, we can find the efficiency of a Carnot engine. So in the next lectures, we'll be solving some problems related to this.